In the 1960s, something inside our TV sets changed. We started using europium, a type of rare earth element, to produce the color red.
That wonderful nose of yours.
Roll the switch.
Yes, europium made the reds on TV redder, but a newspaper report at the time claimed that it made the blues bluer and the greens greener, too. And good news, the US was about to start ramping up its mining and processing of europium and other rare earth elements a lot more. As new electronic devices emerged on the market, these rare earths went inside them. The industry boomed. Cars, speakers, computers were all full of processed neodymium, cerium, and europium. And now, so is your smartphone. In the form of a metal, these rare earth elements look a lot like fool's gold. They're actually called 21st century gold because of their essential role in powering our iPhones, Teslas, F-35 jets, and wind turbines. But they can also be used for economic and geopolitical leverage. For decades, the US was the undisputed leader in rare earths production. But look at this chart right here. This is the exact moment that the US inadvertently handed its rare earths dominance over to China. But China didn't just catch up to where the US was in the 1980s. It took over and grew an empire. Today, China dominates 70% of the market for mining rare earth and 90% of the market for processing them, which is why they've restricted those exports during tariff wars and land disputes. Now, America is trying to claw back its control over one of the most strategically vital industries in the world. I spent the last couple of weeks digging into this story. Not literally. I got all of these from a local rock shop. I wanted to figure out, how exactly did we lose our market dominance to China? And will we be able to bring it back? The funny thing about rare earth elements is they're not really rare. But that doesn't mean that you or I could go out and buy them in their purest forms. If we could, I wouldn't be making this video. So for the sake of this story, let's pretend that these physical props represent the 17 rare earth elements. Elements that you can find on the periodic table. Here's europium, the one that I mentioned earlier that helped make Rudolph's nose red.
My nose, sir?
We call them rare because centuries ago, Swedish chemists started experimenting with them and thought they were unique. And they are. They're found in mineral ores that look like this, that can take millions of years to develop in the Earth's crust, even though they're basically just rocks.
It's a rock! A rock!
Here's where things get a little more tricky. There can be multiple rare earth elements inside just one of these rocks. So it has to go through a lengthy chemical process to separate the rare earth elements inside. I'm gonna spare you the hours it would take for me, the girl who almost failed high school chemistry, to explain that chemical process. But in a nutshell, you can pretty much divide it into two phases. The first phase requires crushing the ore, then grinding it into a very fine powder, then using flotation tanks that float certain minerals to the top and others to the bottom. This creates a concentration of the mineral in which the rare earth elements are chemically bonded. So, ore, mineral, rare earths. Funny story, the shop owner who I bought these rocks from had a real piece of mineral ore, and this is it. The mineral in this one is bastnasite, and it's crucial to first isolate the mineral in phase one and then separate the elements in phase two. Phase two starts by cooking the mineral concentrate, then mixing it with acid to create a solution. Then a process called solvent extraction is used to separate individual rare earth elements chemically. What's left over is a rare earth oxide.
This right here is NdPr oxide, neodymium and praseodymium oxide, and it's at least 99.9% pure.
This is Matt Slochter, the chief communications officer at MP Materials, the company that currently owns and operates the Mountain Pass Rare Earths Mine in Mountain Pass, California. They also made that animated video. The US was the first nation to crack the code on this entire separation process. In 1942, a chemist at Iowa State University developed a revolutionary way to purify the element uranium. That discovery, funded by the Manhattan Project, led to the creation of the atomic bomb during World War II. 7 years later, prospectors in search of uranium in California discovered something even better. A rare earth deposit located about 60 miles southwest of Las Vegas in Mountain Pass, California. A rare earth deposit is just an area where these elements are found in high enough amounts to be worth mining. My rock shopping story gets even crazier because this piece of ore is actually from the Mountain Pass mine and it was dug up in the 1990s. So yes, it does have real rare earth elements inside of it. Oh, by the way, the shop owner let me borrow this. I have to take it back. Don't worry, Walter. I'll bring it back. In 1952, a corporation known today as Molycorp purchased claims to the mine and began rare earth production. And the timing couldn't have been better because the company was able to borrow steps from the separation process developed during the Manhattan Project. But in order to produce industrial scale quantities of rare earth oxides, the company needed to build a large separation plant next to the actual mine. And that's how we got europium in our TV sets. From the 1950s to the 1980s, the US was the world's leading producer and innovator of rare earth elements. One of its most notable achievements was a rare earth supermagnet, first created in the 1960s with support from the US Air Force. You're probably the most familiar with magnets that look something like this. But magnets that look like this play a key role in devices that convert energy in everything from electric cars to generators. The supermagnet that the US Air Force created was partially made of the rare earth samarium. It was revolutionary because it could maintain its strength even under extreme temperatures, which made it ideal for military applications. By the time the 90s rolled around, the US had nearly tripled its production of rare earth oxides and incorporated them into everything from Walkmans to fiber optic cables to camcorders. But let's go back to the 1980s for just a sec. If you zoom in around 1982, you can see that at this point in time, China was slowly catching up to the US in terms of producing rare earth oxides. Because here's the other thing about rare earth elements, you can find them on every continent. So it was never really a matter of if China would disrupt the global rare earths market, it was more a matter of when. But the US was in such a dominant position that it underestimated China's ability to pull ahead. Kind of like how an industry monopoly can become so big that it creates its own vulnerabilities and customer blind spots. That's when small businesses can swoop in and become legitimate competitors. We created an ebook that reveals exactly where these monopoly cracks are forming across 10 major markets and the success stories of entrepreneurs who found their window of opportunity to disrupt them. Our breakdown has a checklist you can use to identify a business idea in one of these industries and validate the potential of that opportunity too. Click the link in the description or scan the QR code on the screen to uncover the 10 industries ripe for disruption in 2025. Before China found its golden opportunity in rare earths, it was a country rife with political and economic turmoil. When the Chinese Communist Revolution ended in 1949, Mao Zedong decided to tighten China's trade with the West and instead focus on trade with other Soviet nations. But come the 1980s, his successor, Deng Xiaoping, was ready to reopen global trade to help restore the country's economic prosperity. Enter rare earths. The Chinese actually discovered rare earth elements in 1927 in Inner Mongolia, but they didn't start officially mining them until 1957, and then it wasn't until the late 70s that large-scale separation processes actually started. But remember, at that point, only the US had figured out how to process them on an industrial scale thanks to the Mountain Pass mine's separation plants. Still, the Chinese government, and Deng Xiaoping in particular, saw rare earths as their great economic hope and were determined to catch up. They developed enhanced mining techniques and invested in R&D to dramatically increase production. And these efforts paid off. China increased its average annual production of rare earth oxides by 40% every year from 1978 to 1989. But something else happened in the 1980s that gave China an even bigger assist in the game of rare earths dominance. In the early 1980s, General Motors and a Japanese corporation, Sumitomo, co-created a permanent magnet that could generate a constant magnetic field without requiring any additional power or electricity. For the auto industry, this was huge. It allowed car makers to introduce new amenities like power seats, but the real upgrade was the motor. Having a permanent magnet made cars much more efficient and powerful because it reduced energy loss. Plus, remember that permanent magnet I mentioned that the US Air Force helped develop, partially made out of samarium? Well, samarium is one of the actually rare earth elements. It typically accounts for less than 1% of the rare earth elements found inside the ore. This newer magnet was made partially out of neodymium, which accounts for about 12 to 18% of an ore's rare earths content. That made the magnet a lot less expensive to produce, and therefore, in huge demand. General Motors started to produce these permanent magnets on a commercial scale through a company it founded called MagnaQuench, which was based in Indiana and whose supply of neodymium came from Molycorp's Mountain Pass mine in California. My coworker Mark wrote an entire article about rare earths and what went down in the 1980s. To learn more, he consulted Jack Lifton, the co-chairman of the Critical Minerals Institute and a veteran engineer in the field of rare earths. According to Lifton, Molycorp couldn't produce enough rare earth oxides to satisfy the growing demand for permanent magnets in the 80s. So it decided to start doing business with China. Now, there are varying accounts and thoughts on what happened next, but Lifton's version is that Molycorp shared its recipe for industrial-scale separation of rare earths with Chinese companies, and that included sharing blueprints for separation facilities. The thought was that these Chinese companies would become suppliers to Molycorp, giving it more product at a lower cost because China's mining operations were cheaper. But that's not all that happened. Lifton claims that Molycorp's separation secrets eventually spread all over China.
Well, that's a fascinating tale. I have no idea how to separate fact from fiction there. But what is undoubtedly true is that the US was a technological pioneer in this industry. And if you look back to the 1980s and 90s, US manufacturers were going around the world to scale up manufacturing abroad, including in China. And I think that led to a lot of good for the world. But I think anyone looking back at this from today's point of view would reasonably arrive at the conclusion that it went too far.
Regardless of what did or didn't happen in the 1980s, as you can see here, it took China around a decade to catch up and then completely dominate the global market. To make matters worse, the US government approved GM's sale of MagnaQuench to Chinese-controlled investors in 1995. And by 2004, all of its operations had moved to China. Just a couple of years earlier in 2002, the Mountain Pass mine was shut down completely, due in part to growing competition from China. And since then, China has quadrupled its output, soaring light years above the rest of the world in rare earth oxides production. The co-founder of MP Materials estimates that as of today, China operates at least 50 rare earth separation plants, compared to only three others in the world, Mountain Pass being one of them. China has also filed more than 25,000 rare earth related patents, allowing it to lead in other industries like consumer electronics, EV manufacturing, and renewable energy. But can the US ever get back to where it was before Molycorp's alleged blueprint blunder? Well, look right here at this little bit of blue starting to come back and climb. MP Materials purchased the Mountain Pass mine in 2017. According to the company, it fixed issues, hired a new team, and was able to scale production dramatically. Today, the mine separation plants are several football fields long. The company believes that a domestic rare earth supply chain in the US is not only possible, but critical, especially in light of China's recent crackdown on exporting rare earths to the US that sent the auto industry into a panic.
It's a total freakout. Panicking is not hyperbolic at all. We've received calls from dozens of manufacturers, automakers, consumer electronics, speakers. I think there's been really a profound awakening in the manufacturing supply chain, not only about the dependency on China, but also just how pervasive they are across daily life.
In 2024, MP Materials produced over 45,000 metric tons of rare earth oxides, the highest output in US history. It's also in a trial production of permanent magnets made of neodymium at its Fort Worth, Texas facility, with commercial magnet production on track for the end of 2025. Now, compared to China's 2024 output of almost 300,000 metric tons and its estimated 90% share of the neodymium magnet market, this might not feel like that much progress. But considering that the mine lay dormant for more than a decade, it's not bad. According to Jack Lifton, the US is unlikely to ever catch up to where China is today. Not surprising. But because the global rare earths market is relatively small compared to steel, for example, Lifton told us that he doesn't think a domestic supply chain is really all that necessary, especially when there are countries other than China that could become our main suppliers.
I couldn't disagree more. We're talking about a $25 billion global industry. In global scale, that's not huge, but it enables the manufacturing of trillions of dollars of goods. And so these types of foundational supply chains are the things we need to make the goods that power modern life. We absolutely must have capacity at home to do these foundational supply chains. It's just not an option.
Steel is another industry dominated by China, but it was once the corporate jewel of America. To hear that cautionary tale, check out our video on the downfall of the American steel industry and why one of the US's biggest steel companies is now being sold off to Japan. And to learn more about the 10 industries ripe for disruption today, check out our ebook linked in the description. All right, I'll see you in the next one.